young woman coming from England to Calcutta as such. They were supposed to marry the young men who were working for East India Company here. The mothers always advised, don't pick up a young man because he may be at a very lower position. Pick up somebody middle-aged man. So that he will have a lot of money and a lot of corruption. So they were given advice right from their home. This showed the amount of corruption, and that created some kind of a disrespect and also a revolt and upsurge against the East India Company also because of their corruption. Though back in England, some of them had to face cases also. As a matter of fact, the second most powerful and important person in the colonial history of India, Warren Hastings, was prosecuted by court when he went back after retirement to England as such for his corruption and cases as such. So that was taken care of by that time, whatever he wanted to do, he had done it. So corruption is another thing. Extraction of maximum land revenue is another thing. Complete indifference to people as such. If you rule over people, however indifferent you may be in this and that, you have to take minimum understanding, minimum things, that this has to be done. So these were the things which created tremendous disaffection among the population. And the third thing which happened, which I would not say, I have a very mixed response towards it, is that the British also effected the lords, the landlords, the local Hindu and Muslim landlords, who were called Talukedar, Zagirdar, and so on and so forth. Huge amount of land they had, and they were also collecting tax from their subjects as such and giving it to the king. Now, there was not much of documentation as such. One good thing that the English had, and that they used to document everything, even a single penny expenditure was there in the book as such. But there was not much of documentation. Though during the time of Great Akbar, the land was assessed in a big way. But after that, there was, because India went through very tumultuous period, very difficult period itself. So no new assessment of the land even was done. It was done by an English officer called Sleeman. His name has come in that movie, Chess Players also. Sleeman was referred to number 9. Sleeman was a very strong officer. He tried to pick up the map of every district as such and find out who belongs to where and what sort of land holding one has and this and that, etc. Now that created some kind of problem for the local landlords, local lords, because they were now capturing all the land as such, and there was hardly any record in this and that. So they fled. So they were not very much happy. They were also angry because the English had overrun them. But it was mixed kind of thing. It was that also English took over the land also. They had one what we call indigo plantation. The English landlords came here in India, settled down. Thousands of acres of land they took, and they tried to build up indigo plantations as such. They stopped the local peasantry from growing crops as such. And they said that you have to work here. And because they were the ruling class, so the poor fellows had to work. But then they didn't have anything to eat. If you do indigo, you can't do wood. Eat indigo. Indigo was the blue thing for making white grain as such. Incidentally, Mahatma Gandhi, when he came to India in 1916 back from South Africa, his first movement was against the indigo farming in Champaran and Bihar. And he put up a large petition on behalf of this Champaran village. This is the centenary year, 1917, he did it, of the Champaran struggle. So that the new government had to close down, and he highlighted the plight of the poor. 4 billion GSMs. That was the first act that he did in India. Because he, from 1893 to 1915, he was in South Africa, he was not in India. For 23 years, he practiced law and fought the battle for the people in South Africa. And then he came back in 1516. He started traveling over India. Champaran was the first experiment that he did. So this kind of things were happening in various parts of the country itself. There was also, you know, I found it very interesting. There was this resentment against the medicine. Modern hospital system. Now, the Indians had their own hospital system. Yunani medicine, there is the Muslim medicine, and the Hindu medicine was Ayurvedic medicine. But then, as rumors go, people said that what kind of skins and animal fat and this and that is there in these medicines and so on and so forth. It is not warranted by our religion and so on and so forth. Once plague happened in a city called Pune, and the British soldiers entered in the houses as such and they picked up people and they dragged them to hospital and this and that. That created resentment. As a matter of fact, Mahatma Gandhi's only book and the first book, it's called Hind Swaraj, the Home Rule in India as such, which was banned in 1921. He wrote about this. We can understand, as Gandhi used to say, many things which look like very utopian and very difficult. And he looked like a very medieval person sometimes, hates you. But now I can understand why. There were some reasons, and something was floating around in the space. So, this is this. And then, of course, the root of India, which was so much known as it. I don't remember exactly the name of that man, but he has the kind of a very ubiquitous, normal Swedish name, von Lindbergh, who was commissioned by the Queen of England, that is Victoria, to make drawings because they didn't have the cameras. Though camera photographs are there, very, very bad. But that was just early period. So he was asked, he was the official drawing man for the whole East India Company takeover of Lucknow and all that. I saw that book, you know, and he has made drawings of officers of East India Company looting houses in Lucknow and taking jewelry and this and that, etc., etc. Though he was commissioned by the Queen, he should not have done that, perhaps. But he did. Whatever he saw, he just drew. So one of the things which is there, it's still in our archives, Indian archives, it's a whole file, it's just called loot. The whole pile is called loot. And this loot is largely, it's one of the largest things was Lucknow. Because Lucknow was a very prosperous place, merchant-wise, business-wise, taxation-wise, and the Nawabs had huge amount of jewelry in this place, in which he has one, and there are about hundreds of files within that file, yes. But one file number 12 has about 41 items. And if you go through those 41 items, each item you answer, you will start wondering as to how much was looted here. Diamond, pearl, gold, silver, and that file of loot, it is still there in our archive of Delhi. And it is incidentally called loot. So loot file is there. And this was another thing which changed the mind of people in correspondent, Mr. Marx, also. Because he also read about it. Because the discussion came in Parliament, House of Commons, about this loot of Lucknow. So he wrote about it. And he changed his mind that the colonialism is not about the good things, colonialism is about the loot as such. So it's kind of, tunnels were built up in which jewelries were kept and whole jewelry was taken over. Houses were pillaged. The houses of the Sarukedar, Zagirdar, Nawabs, and of course the Ras Nawab also, and all those things. And these happened. Now the fourth thing that I wanted to talk about is common people and subaltern view about the 1857 itself, which affected the whole 1857 scenario. There is a story, I don't know whether it will be substantiated by many, but there is a storyline also that because of the caste structure in Hindu society, the soldiers were very much, divided as such, within the caste as such. The upper caste naturally didn't like the lower caste as such. And lower caste had their own things to do as such. So there is a story which goes about, and it is very much there in the Dalit literature and Dalit history, which is now coming up in more prominence. People are talking about it, that in the Barakpur cantonment of the East India Company, within the campus of the cantonment, there was one sweeper, a person who was a scavenger, and naturally belonging to untouchable caste, that is how they were picked up, caste wise. He was sitting and he was right there, and there was a Brahmin soldier called Mangal Pandey. He was cleaning his utensils as such and taking water out. This fellow was very thirsty. He asked, "Can I have some little bit of water?" He said, "You are an untouchable, I'm not going to give you any water or anything kind of thing." Now then this scavenger fellow, he said, "Oh, I see. So you will not give water to me because then you will pollute it. But do you know what English I'm doing with you? You have to uncork bullets which has tallow of pig and beef. So your dharma is already gone, you are no more a Hindu." So this embraced Mangal Pandey like anything. And he was one of the first victims, he was the first one to, inside the Barakpur to come to be old as such. The question of tallow and this and that may be there, but it's not still completely substantiated whether it was there or not, whatever it is. And later on it was also revised that nothing will be done, nothing will be kept there. The soldiers had to break it from their teeth, bullet as such in those days, 1960. So I'm saying this is the Dalit view, subaltern view from below as such. So the revolt also came because of various other sections. On the other hand, in Western India, in Bombay, the Mahars were untouchable, and it was one of the Mahar who became an iconic figure in Indian history, Baba Saheb Ambedkar. So Mahar regiment was also picked up in the East India Company army. So that's why there was no revolt in Bombay, because everybody was backward caste, lower caste, untouchable, this and that. There was no revolt. There was no revolt in Madras. There was no revolt within the Sikh regiment. Six were one who released.